Hey, Lower Elementary, welcome to your Bible class time. I'm glad you guys continue to join us and get into your Bibles and to learn about God, because that's just going to grow your faith more and more. The more you know about Him and the more you put the things that you learn into practice and you try Him out, the more you learn to trust God and to rely on Him. Let's go ahead and pray. Dear Father, we thank you so much for not leaving us the way that we are, but for transforming us, for molding us and shaping us. And I pray that you continue to grow our knowledge, but also make that a knowledge that's deep in our hearts. We love you so much. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. All right, I'm going to play a little game with you. You know, God is in the business of transformation. He transforms tadpoles into frogs and caterpillars into these butterflies and moths. In spring, you might have noticed how everything's opening up. He transforms what seems like dead branches into branches full of life and leaves. And he takes these tiny little seeds and he transforms them, and then they open up and this green plant grows out of them. I want to see how good you are at noticing transformations, even subtle ones. So I'm going to have you close your eyes and do not open them until I tell you you can. Okay, ready? One, two, three. Close your eyes. All right, you can open them. What's different? Did you notice? Let's try that again. Okay, ready? One, two, three. Close your eyes. All right, you can open them. What's different now? Do you notice? All right, ready? One, two, three. Close your eyes. All right, you can open them. Now it's different. Okay, one more time. Ready? One, two, three. Close your eyes. All right, now you can open them. Ta-da! Transformation. And you know, this is what God does in our lives. It might seem like small transformations at first, but to people watching, we see these. He takes us from one creature and changes us and transforms us into something completely different. And it's a big enough transformation that people notice. They notice, hey, something's different about you. You're patient and kind and loving, and you serve others, and you're more compassionate. People notice the ways that God transforms our hearts and our lives. And we're going to, as soon as I take all of this stuff off, we're going to talk about a huge biblical transformation of a man named Saul. So go ahead and grab your Bibles, and I'm going to share my screen with you. All right, so turn to Acts chapter 9. We're going to look at verses 1 through 22. So now in the Bible, God often changed people's names to add new meaning to them. Abram became Abraham, Jacob became Israel, and Simon became Peter. So when we first meet Paul, the Apostle Paul, his name is Saul. Why two names? I'm going to explain that soon, but first, when we meet him, Saul is quite wicked. He has been persecuting the church, Jesus's church, and the Jews did not like the disciples of Jesus, and they were trying to hurt them. And Saul was one of these Jews. He was a Pharisee, and he knew the law inside and out, but his heart was hard. It needed a change. He was in charge of arresting and even killing Jesus's followers. So we learn in verses 1 and 2. Meanwhile, Saul was still breathing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciples, and he went to the high priest to ask him for letters to the synagogue in Damascus, so that if he found anyone there who belonged to the way, which are the believers of Jesus, whether men or women, he might take them as prisoners to Jerusalem. So, but on his way to attack and harm these Christians, something remarkable happens, and Jesus comes in and takes over the show. Let's find out what happens next. So here you can see Jerusalem, and Paul is traveling north on this road to Damascus. As he neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice say to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" "Who are you, Lord?" Saul asked. "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting," he replied. "Now get up and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do." The men traveling with Saul stood there speechless. They heard the sound, but they did not see anyone. Well, Saul got up from the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand into Damascus, and for 3 days he was blind and did not eat or drink anything. So can you imagine for this miracle? We now know it's a miracle. Saul was probably just completely shocked, and it really radically transformed him very quickly. Okay, but now he cannot see. So Saul's companions couldn't figure out what's going on. Jesus was there taking control. And meanwhile, though, back in Damascus, there's a man named Ananias who worked hard to serve God. And one day, God shared something with Ananias. So in Damascus, there was a disciple named Ananias, and the Lord called to him in a vision, "Ananias." "Yes, Lord," he answered. The Lord told him, "Go to the house of Judas on Straight Street and ask for a man from Tarsus named Saul, for he is praying. In a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias come and place his hands on him to restore his sight." "Lord," Ananias answered, "I have heard many reports about this man and all the harm he has done to your people in Jerusalem. And he has come here with authority from the chief priest to arrest all who call on your name." But the Lord said to Ananias, "Go. This man is my chosen instrument to proclaim my name to the Gentiles and their kings and to the people of Israel. I will show him how he must suffer for my name." So imagine being told that you need to go find and talk to maybe the head of a terrorist group or a school bully or whoever your biggest enemy might be. That would be pretty scary. And it might be tempting to say, "No way, I am not going to do this. This is crazy." That might be how Ananias felt. Saul was hurting Christians. He was famous for hurting Christians. So why would God tell anyone to go talk to him? What would you do? Let's see how Ananias responded. "Then Ananias went to the house and entered it, and placing his hands on Saul, he said, 'Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you were coming here, has sent me so that you might see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit.' Well, immediately something like scales fell from Saul's eyes and he could see again. He got up and was baptized, and after taking some food, he regained his strength. And Saul spent several days with the disciples in Damascus. At once he began to preach in the synagogues that Jesus is the Son of God. All those who heard him were astonished, and they asked, 'Isn't this the man who raised havoc in Jerusalem among those who call on this name? And hasn't he come here to take them prisoners to the chief priest?' Yet Saul grew more and more powerful and baffled the Jews living in Damascus by proving that Jesus is the Messiah." Ananias obeyed. It was God asking, after all. It was Jesus, and found Saul there just as he was promised. And immediately Saul was healed, and he realized that it was God who was responsible for this experience. Saul was baptized, and he started to shock people right away by spreading the word of Jesus around and teaching. He was changed, not just in a week or a month or a very slow incremental transformation, but this was an immediate 180-degree change, completely flipped around. He began to work right after this encounter. And it probably helped that Ananias followed directions and he prayed. You know, prayer is really important, isn't it? So Paul went on to become perhaps the most influential and important figure of the church spread and the new faith, right? So speaking of change, what about the name business that I mentioned earlier? Remember how Saul's name changed to Paul? Well, Saul just so happens to be his Hebrew name, okay? And when he started his missionary work, remember he was supposed to go to the Gentiles. Do you know what Gentiles are? Gentiles are anybody who is not Jewish. So unless you have a Jewish heritage, you're a Gentile. And so he changed from his Jewish name, Saul, to Paul, which was his name in Latin, because already he was thinking about the people that he was going to be sharing Jesus with, the Gentiles. And so he was wanted to be more open to them. So much so that he even changed his name from Saul to Paul. Isn't that an incredible story? Okay, whoops, we're not going to talk about that. That's, you know what, if you want to go and read the next six verses, you're going to find out about Saul getting lowered in a basket, raised up in a basket. All right, so our verse today is serve one another in love. That's Galatians chapter 5, verse 13. And Saul killed many Christians and persecuted them. And then Jesus transformed his heart, and now he is serving in love. So did anyone in our Bible story do what this verse says other than Paul? Serve one another in love? What do you think? If you said Ananias, you would be correct. How did Ananias serve? And how did Saul serve? And how did Jesus transform Saul? All right, I have a worksheet for you. You can cut out these pictures and put them in the correct order of the story. See if you can remember what the order of our story. That'll help you remember the story better, won't it? And that's all I've got for you. Okay. You guys take care, and I can't wait to see you again. And we're going to be learning about, I think, Silas next lesson. I'm not sure. We'll see. Take care. Miss you guys. I love you guys. Bye.